Nearly 20 years after the birth of Megadeth, the band's disciples still embrace its sound and cynicism with fanatical fervor.
You feed off the energy of the music, the speed, the heaviness. You get to slam dance and stage dive.
They're always heavier than everybody else.
It's an energy, it's an adrenaline, and it's a rush.
It was so brutally heavy, I'm like, man, that's great.
You get in the pit or you get out on the floor, you better be ready. You better bring some, I don't know, Novocaine.
After two decades of Megadeth mania, fans still pay homage to the band with bruises and blood.
I've just come home so beaten and bruised and bloody. I mean, I broke two ribs at a show.
But for years, the group's founders inflicted an even more punishing toll on themselves.
Smoke pot, hash, opium, psychedelics and speed, crosstops, black beauties, magic mushrooms, LSD.
Sometimes I'd wake up in the morning and just be like, man.
Quaaludes.
I can't believe how I feel right now.
Heroin, cocaine, crack, freebase.
It's shocking to me that we're still around.
Morphine, Demerol. China White.
Frontman Dave Mustaine is Megadeth's chief architect of Armageddon. It was his vision that sired the band, and ultimately his addictions that threatened to end it.
I ended up going to treatment 15 times total before I got sober this time. I think every time I went in there, I had the intentions of this being my last time. But it's like making love with a gorilla. You don't stop till the gorilla's done.
In a way, Dave's demons are not surprising, because the specter of addiction has haunted him since the day he was born. Dave's road to metal madness began September 13, 1961, in La Mesa, California. He was born into the family of Emily Mustaine and her husband John, a respected banker with a terrible secret.
He was a violent drunk. I kind of feared him because of his drinking.
My dad could be very, very cruel to David at times. I know one time he disciplined him by grabbing his ear with a pair of pliers and dragging him down the driveway home.
The youngest of four children and the only son, Dave was four when his parents divorced in the summer of 65. His wife and kids moved out, but John Mustaine wasn't finished menacing his family.
We'd move, my dad would find us, we'd move again, he'd find us. I never saw a moving van during the day. We'd always move at night and he would find my mom and we'd run.
There was little solace in a life on the run, although Dave and his sister Debbie were able to get some relief from music.
She used to play like Cat Stevens and Elton John music.
It's not time to make a change, just relax, take it easy.
I think that's where a lot of the melody that I learned came from was, you know, Cat Stevens is a fantastic songwriter.
You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to go through.
Dave's mother cleaned houses to support the family. She and the kids paid a heavy price for their reversal of fortune.
We had hand-me-downs all the time, and kids would make fun of me pretty hard because you have pants in there up around your ankle bones and stuff like that. Kids are wicked, you know.
In the fall of 69, when Dave was eight, Emily Mustaine scraped together enough money to buy Dave a guitar. His sisters didn't find Dave's early efforts encouraging.
He was trying to teach himself how to play at that time. He said, you know, you're making a lot of noise, put it away, you're never gonna learn how to play a guitar.
Debbie found something not to her liking, so she broke the guitar over my head. That kind of ended the guitar for a while.
Dave soon found a more suitable outlet for the anger that was growing within him, playing catcher on a Little League baseball team.
Nobody got past David coming into home plate. Even if he didn't have the ball, he'd block them.
If they came and tried to cross the plate, I'd deck them. And the parents all hated me and would boo me whenever I would come up to bat or anything like that because I was, you know, really mean.
In February 75, the family moved in with his older sister, Suzanne, who'd relocated to Stanton, California, and married a local cop named Bob Wilkie. A religious man, Bob saw nothing but the devil in a raucous record Dave brought home.
Sad Wings of Destiny, great Judas Priest record, and he didn't like it. I said something he found unfavorable and clobbered me.
By the time he was 15, Dave was ready to strike out on his own. So in the fall of 76, he got his own apartment, began selling pot, and dove headfirst into a world of drugs and music.
I started to deal pot because there's not really any other way for a 15-year-old to make money besides peddling your ass, and I wasn't into that. And I was dealing drugs to someone who worked at a record store, and she would come and have sex with me during the day, and then she would drop off records, and I'd give her pot. And she'd go back to work. That's how I got my first Iron Maiden record. That's how I got my first Motorhead record. Full-blown English evil music. Part of the whole style I even have right now is obviously indebted to her being a dope fiend, you know?
By the spring of 1978, David dropped out of high school and picked up an electric guitar.
I started to see the way people would fawn for guitar players. You know, the girls were just crazy about these guys, and the guys would, you know, give them drugs and alcohol and stuff like that. I thought, you know, free pussy, free alcohol, free drugs, I'm in. Where do I sign up?
Playing faster and heavier than his hard rock heroes, he soon cobbled together a speed metal band called Panic. And through the group's small-time gigs, he glimpsed the first signs of salvation.
I liked the power that it gave me. I was very power drunk from it, you know, and people knew my name and they wanted to hang around with me, and the quality of the girls were going up very rapidly, and I thought, this is great.
At 17, Dave was his own man and afraid of nothing. In June of 78, he tracked down his father, John, and arranged to have a beer with him a few days later. But his father would never keep the appointment.
I get a call from one of my sisters saying that he'd had an accident.
My dad had a very serious aneurysm, and no one knew how to get a hold of the family. So it was about 2 days before they finally got a hold of me, and by that time it was too late to give permission to really do anything to help him.
When Dave got the news from his sister Suzanne, he was in the midst of a drinking binge. Still, he raced to the hospital.
I rode on a moped with a bottle of old granddad in my pocket, drinking straight whiskey, running red lights. I showed up drunk. My sister Suzanne, she looked at me and she said, "You're gonna end up just like him." And I'll be damned if she wasn't right.
John Mustaine died on June 23rd, 1978, but his death did nothing to slow his son's growing addictions.
I'd already tried psychedelics, LSD, and mushrooms and stuff like that. And everything was legal to me because I answered to my own set of angels. When I realized I was a drug addict and an alcoholic, I didn't think, oh my God, I'm like Otis from Mandy and Mayberry, you know? I thought, oh my God, I'm Keith Richards. I'm James Dean. I'm cool.
Within a year, Dave was freebasing cocaine and getting bored with Panic. Then in the fall of 81, he saw a newspaper ad for a guitar player. It had been placed by a band called Metallica.
There was an ad in there for lead guitarist wanted, and they had said they were looking for someone influenced by Iron Maiden and Motorhead.
I just got this phone call from this guy who basically just called up and started talking. I mean, after hello, I don't think I said anything for like the next 10 minutes. He was just going blah, 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 blah.
So I go to audition for this band, and I took my amps and everything, and I plugged in, and I'm warming up.
He had this shrieking lead sound that would cut through any soundproofing. Everything just was exploding out of everywhere of him.
I said, "Well, are we going to audition?" And they said, "No, you got the job."
Dave Mustaine believed he'd finally found a place in the world where he fit in. But his sanctuary would be short-lived. Next, Mustaine and Metallica duke it out.
He was on the road to killing possibly all of us at one point.
And later, Dave's dance with death.
They took me to an emergency room and then I died.
In the fall of 81, future Megadeth frontman Dave Mustaine finally found an artful outlet for his aggression with Metallica. The band was at the cutting edge of a musical revolution called thrash, a fusion of punk rock and hardcore heavy metal.
It was angst and testosterone driven, about anarchy and things like that. Four of us were the detonation, the beginning of something that was going to really affect music forever.
With songs like Jump in the Fire, Metallica cranked up the oral anger of seminal metal bands like Motorhead, clashing head-on with the glam groups dominating the LA music scene.
So tell me what you think about glam rock.
To me, glam rock stands, glam means gay LA music.
We had grown up in LA and saw all of the BS rock star podium, you know, big wig hairdo stuff, and we were so against any of that. Could you please welcome
Metallica? Metallica spent a year perfecting their sonic jabs in clubs and studios, proving that their bad boy image was no act.
When I would go to rehearsal, I would leave the dogs there to watch the drugs. And one day I took one of the dogs with me, and she put her paws up on Ron McGovney's car and scratched the front panel.
The pit bull started jumping on my car, scratching it all up. And I hear James yelling at Dave saying, "Hey, get your freaking dogs off of Ron's car."
And James kicked the dog. Now, everyone thinks I kicked James' dog, and it wasn't that way. James kicked my dog, and that's where we went, "Don't do this, oh, don't do this, or you're going to get fired."
And I hear James yelling at Dave's, and all of a sudden Dave just came unglued. "Don't you say this kind of crap about my dogs," and they're nose to nose.
"Shut up or I'm going to hit you." And then the bass player goes, "You hit him, you're going to have to hit me first." And then James goes, "You hit him, you're going to have to hit me first." And I said, "You win, James," and I belted him in the mouth.
Knocked him across the room. I mean, he wasn't even expecting it.
And the bass player jumped me and I flipped him.
He threw me against the wall like a big judo throw. And we just got him to, "Get out of here, you're out of the band, you know? All right, F you, blah, blah, blah." And then goes in, packs up all his stuff, leaves, comes back the next day. "Can I be back in the band?" You go, "All right, okay, you're back in the band." Dave was pretty much a Jekyll and Hyde.
That started perpetuating the Dave's an asshole rumor, because as far as anybody knew, I was just a badass on guitar that liked to fight and drink.
Well, it just got worse. I wasn't home one time, and Dave was sitting there drinking, and my bass was on a guitar stand, and he decided to take a whole beer and just pour it right into the pickups on my bass, just down the whole thing in there. I didn't know anything about it. Go plug it in. About blew me across the room, shocked the hell out of me. I told Dave, "Look, you guys get the F out of my house. James, get out. You're going to have to leave. I mean, that's it. I can't take it anymore."
Within weeks, McGovney was out of the band.
He just was not dangerous. You know, if you're going to be in Metallica, you're four badass. It's not, you know, three men and a baby, you know.
They came in the U-Haul, loaded up their stuff, and they were off to San Francisco.
Metallica moved their angry act to San Francisco and hired bass player Cliff Burton. The city by the bay soon became heavy metal headquarters.
They were gods in San Francisco. They were selling 3,000-4,000 tickets to shows. They were legends before they ever released a record.
We felt a lot more comfortable up there, and the whole flashy side of LA just wasn't so prominent up there, you know?
On stage, Dangerous Dave was part of Metallica's instant attraction.
"How many of you have a middle finger?"
Dave was outspoken, did a lot of talking into the microphone, which I thought was very unusual for a guy who was not singing at all. He was playing the role of bad boy. And he played it well. I mean, he was a pretty scary guy.
It seemed to me like I was the leader of the band because I had big balls and I wasn't going to take shit from anybody.
Metallica quickly drew allegiance from an underground army of angst-ridden teens already armed with the sounds of the new wave of British heavy metal.
We were all followers of the new wave of British heavy metal.
Metallica's music was kind of like these groups, but Americanized, more powerful, more straightforward.
I had never heard like such a twin rhythm guitar kind of deal going on. Their music just had more speed or something to it, and it blew me away.
You couldn't read about it in mainstream magazines. You couldn't hear it on the radio. There certainly was no MTV or videos or VH1. It was really about a network.
By the beginning of 1983, Metallica had punched out a 7-song demo tape, No Life Till Leather, that quickly became legendary in the American metal underground.
What the music was speaking about, the lyrics and the lifestyle, that really hit home to a lot of kids for that time period.
We are you and you are us. On the No Life Till Leather demo, James says, we are Metallica, you are Metallica. And that was sort of the ethic that lived, you know, with all these fans and all these bands.
That March, aspiring metal manager Johnny Zazula heard the tape and convinced Metallica to move to New York.
Are you planning to do any recording soon?
May 1st, Rochester, New York.
With James Hetfield's pickup in tow, Metallica hit the road in a U-Haul.
The back went down and you were locked in there, and whatever happened back there, you know, if you could afford a flashlight, you were king, you know? But there was no light, no anything back there. You just get rotted and sleep, you know, hopefully. I hope the gear didn't fall and crush you.
While I was in the back of this truck, rust came down from the ceiling and got in my eyes. I said, I gotta get to an emergency room because I've got metal shavings in my eyes, and they didn't want to stop till we got to Old Bridge.
Dave's dark side soon got the best of him.
There's two kinds of drunks. There's happy drunks and there's violent drunks. And I would get violent.
He just went like totally psycho on some people in this restaurant and almost caused this big fight.
We started to see that he was on the road to killing possibly all of us.
Before they even reached New York, James and Lars were listening to other bands' demos, hoping to find a replacement for Dave Mustaine.
We're playing tapes in the cab of the truck while he's asleep in the back on some stained mattress. I mean, that was the whole ugliness of that U-Haul trip.
Metallica arrived in New York in April of 83. Their first order of business was to rid themselves of Dave Mustaine.
All I remember was waking up and then being circled around me, and I just looked up.
Wake up, Dave, you know.
Get up, you're out of the band. And I said, what, no warning, no second chance?
It was almost like execution style. We just walked in, woke him up, fired him, grabbed him in his shit, and took him down to the bus stop. And the whole thing took, you know, 45 minutes.
It does sound pretty bad, you know, wake up, bye. But it really had to happen that way.
The breakup was hard on everybody.
I remember this like it was yesterday. I was sitting in the back of James's pickup when they drove me to the bus station. And I looked at James and he was weeping.
You know, we were brothers up to that point, and then something had pulled us apart, and we knew it had to continue that way, so it was emotional for all of us.
I'd seen my dad in a coma and dying, and this was probably more harmful to me than anything I'd ever been through.
Dave spent the next 4 days on a bus bound for Los Angeles, seething over his expulsion.
I hated him. I was so mad at them, and I figured I need to regroup and I need to start over again because now I'm going to get revenge. Part of the whole reason why I formed Megadeth was to get back at them. To the story, we'll cut you
down. Man, here it is. The birthplace of Megadeth.
Mustaine's challenge to Metallica began coming together just 2 months later in his Hollywood apartment complex.
That was Dave Mustaine's apartment right up there.
There was some guy living underneath me.
And I was living right down below.
And he was playing bass first thing in the morning, full blast.
It was Running with the Devil by Van Halen. So I was sitting there going, bum, bum, bum.
I have nothing against Van Halen, but that's the most horrible bass line to listen to if you're hungover.
Bum, bum, bum.
And all of a sudden, I hear this flower pot come smashing down onto my air conditioner. And I heard this guy yelling, shut up!
Shut up!
Shut up! And it stopped.
The bass player was 18-year-old David Ellefson, a native of the tiny town of Jackson, Minnesota. David had his sights set on rock stardom before he'd graduated middle school.
He formed a little group, probably about 13, 14 years old, and played on the front porch. Mothers made sandwiches and lemonade and invited all the neighbors in and all the kids.
All I wanted to do was be in a rock band. That was it.
In the summer of 83, David left Minnesota and headed to L.A. to chase his dream.
We had a lot of reservations. People would say, how can you let him go out to L.A.? That's where they're going to do drugs, they're going to do this and that and the other. But we thought, well, he was going to school, and we just had to kind of trust along the way.
I told my parents, well, look, there's a school out there called Musicians Institute, and maybe I'll go there.
Although he was accepted into the school, David would never take a class because within days, he collided with Dave Mustaine.
Well, these neighbors aren't too friendly here in California like they are back in Minnesota.
I hear this on my door, and I open the door, and there's these two kids.
Gives me this kind of like condescending look, the infamous Mustaine snarl.
And they go, hey, you know where to get some cigarettes? And I went,
yeah, down the street at the liquor store, and slams the door in my face.
Hey, are you old enough to buy beer? And I said, now you're talking.
We hooked up and went down the street, got a case of Heineken.
The rest is history. That's how David Ellefson got in the band.
Mustaine quickly took Ellefson under his wing, introducing him to hard drugs and a frantic musical style.
He was playing this stuff, and I was just, I was mesmerized. I was like, I have never heard anything like that before. That is cool.
The two began auditioning lead singers for the band, but none of them could match Mustaine's intensity.
Dave was driven, you know? I mean, you could almost say that he is possessed in a way. I remember the night that Dave just said, you know, fuck it, I'm just gonna sing, you know?
Even before the band's lineup was complete, Dave Mustaine had settled on a name for it, a word he'd stumbled upon during his darkest hour.
When I came home from New York in the bus, there was a handbill. I was writing lyrics on the back of everything. I'm bored, so I flip it over, and it's from Senator Alan Cranston, and he says, "The Arsenal of Megadeth can't be written." I thought, great song title. So I write the song Megadeth.
But the song turned into Set the World Afire. Megadeth minus 1A became the name of the band.
I remember calling home to talk to my parents, you know, because in Minnesota they talk like the people from Fargo, you know, so they're like, oh yeah, what's the name of the band? And like, Megadeth.
Oh yeah, you know, Megadeth. Here we go.
Buzz about the formation of the new band ran rampant throughout the metal underground.
The network started to spread information, and it spread like wildfire.
We would get letters from all around the world.
And I remember all these kids writing, man, it's gonna be fast, it's gonna be fast, it's gotta be fast. And one day we go to rehearsal, and everything's bumped up about 20 beats per minute. Next thing you know, we're a speed metal band. I mean, it happened like that.
Now Megadeth needed to add to their numbers. In November 83, jazz fusion vet Gar Samuelson arrived for an audition and made a searing impression.
The guy comes, and he falls asleep with a cigarette in his hand, and it burns right clear through his fingers, and I thought, this is rad.
Behind the drum set, it was just like, he was like a praying mantis or something, you know? And you just could not see what he was doing. It was something to watch him play.
Gar's fluid playing lended a sense of order to Dave's outrageous riffs. And as the band began playing gigs, the metal audience was all too ready for the man too maniacal for Metallica. Well, here I
come. The people in the audience were just freaking out, man. I mean, Dave could have told them, all right, go out on the street right now and kill the first person you see, and they would have, you know? That's the kind of vibe it was.
Guitarist Chris Poland, who'd played with Gar Samuelson in a jazz band, instantly went backstage and asked in to Gar's new group.
They gave us such an unpredictable chemistry, not only because of the drug part, but because of the playing part. Chris is an amazing guitar player, could play circles around me, and he wanted to be in the band, and that was the first real lineup, was Gar, Chris, David Ellefson, and myself.
With his lineup complete, Dave Mustaine was finally ready to answer Metallica with a band of his own.
People were just frantic. I mean, it was just like electricity.
I had never seen anything like that. No one ever reacted to music like that.
Next, Megadeth on a rampage.
It was no bad boy image, man. We were just out of control.
We were just, you know, all guns blazing. And at all times, 24/7.
And later, Dave Mustaine gives in to the needle.
I finally realized that, you know, the jig's up. I've lost this battle. I'll never win.
Just months after his expulsion from Metallica, Dave Mustaine rebounded by forming a rival band called Megadeth. But in the winter of 83, his old bandmate stole his thunder when they released their debut album, Kill 'Em All.
I remember the day Kill 'Em All came out, and I listened to it, and I heard the first song, and my stuff was on there. I was fuming because I told him not to use my music.
His ex-bandmates maintained Dave said nothing of the kind. Still, Mustaine was now more determined than ever to outmuscle Metallica. He sped up the tempo of Megadeth's assault and made his lyrics even more nihilistic.
We're going to do basically what we set out to do, and that's break all the rules and have as much fun while we're doing it as we can.
The mission statement was to have the fastest,
utmost heaviest,
utmost furious,
ultra furious
metal band ever.
We didn't care about the future. We just wanted to be the most dangerous band on the planet.
Then it was in our contract to, you know, to basically break all the laws of God and man, I guess, you know. So that's what we did.
From day one, Megadeth's members made Danger a personal mission. Mustaine and Ellefson's appetite for self-destruction was matched by Chris Pollan and Gar Samuelson.
They played jazz. They also lived a jazz lifestyle, which meant for a lot of jazz players, heroin.
That was the first time that I really saw a bona fide heroin addict. I mean, I was like, we ain't Kansas anymore, Toto.
You want to be great, you had to do heroin. That's straight out of Gar's mouth. And I thought, you know what, I want to be great.
While Chris and Gar were full-blown junkies, Mustaine and Ellefson were soon snorting heroin and mixing it with cocaine, a deadly cocktail known as a speedball.
It was great. The heroin helped you come down off the cocaine.
Now I knew why everybody did speedballs. I know why they did it. And I forgot that everybody died from it. I forgot that part.
It was no bad boy image, man. We were just out of control.
The band's reckless ways only fed their growing reputation in the metal underground. When Megadeth made a demo tape in the summer of 84, it quickly sparked a bootleg bonanza. Within weeks, the tape fell into the hands of New York record exec Barry Cobrin.
Once I heard the cassette, it was like, wow. You know, I mean, we have another Metallica in our hands.
I could have sounded just like Metallica if I wanted to, and I didn't. Megadeth doesn't sound anything like Metallica. It really doesn't.
Cobrin's Combat Records had financed the label that released Metallica's debut album. He quickly signed Megadeth and rushed the band into the studio.
They gave us $8,000 to make the record. We spent half of that on food and dope. Chris would stop in the middle of a take to go into the bathroom to shoot up, and Gar wouldn't show up for hours because he was buying balloons of heroin. And David Ellefson and I, we always had our amount that we needed to get by.
I would get these frantic calls saying, the studio's a shambles. We've got all this drug paraphernalia here. I mean, it was frightening.
Now this place, 665 Berendo, which is just off of Melrose. We're actually over in kind of East Hollywood right now. This used to be, I guess years ago, a recording studio, but it was a rehearsal studio by the time Dave and I found the place. And it was a place called Mars Studios. And I actually worked here for a short while because we were so broke and needed somehow to make some money. So I actually worked here for a little while. And a guy named Hanley actually gave me a job here, which was great because then after hours and off the books, I could kind of slide Megadeth in and we could do some free rehearsals here, which was great. And actually, we did a lot of rehearsing here with Gar Samuelson. We did a lot of writing, I think, for Killing Is My Business here. And Chris Pollan did a lot of rehearsing here with us as well. Because there was a phase where Chris was playing with us when we were recording Killing Is My Business, and then he bailed out of the band for a while, and then he came back in for a bit. And that's why he didn't do the tour for Killing Is My Business. Another guy by the name of Mike Albert did. And then Chris came back in, and that was when we continued on and through the Peace Sells era with both Chris and Gar. So this place, man, what a dump. This place was dilapidated, but man, we did a lot of partying, did a lot of songwriting, and a lot of jamming here. It was cool.
The session's edgy, angry sound was on raw display in Megadeth's debut album, Killing Is My Business, and business is good. Released in May of 85, the record got good reviews in both metal and mainstream rock magazines. While the music was a tour de force, the album's artwork was more of a joke.
Somewhere we fucked up the artwork. We lost the artwork, and it caused a major to-do.
David wanted an illustration of his own creation, Vic Rattlehead, to adorn the cover of the album. But the label had another idea.
The first album cover was not the way we wanted it. It's a plastic skull with tinfoil on it and bones with pickles and ketchup on it. I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, boy, did we get cheated.
The first thing I thought of was low budget. But the title made up for everything.
With an album to support, Megadeth began peeling the paint from concert venues from coast to coast.
The early days, we didn't have any place to live. So going on the road was great. We finally had a place to live. You know, and I remember like looking at the itinerary or something and going, oh man, the tour's gonna end. Now what am I gonna do? Now who am I gonna go back to LA and live with?
During the next 4 years, they would rarely come off the road.
We'd be driving around the country in a motorhome.
Doing heroin and coke every day.
And just psycho. You know, we're out of our minds and playing clubs.
Smoking pot every day and drinking every day.
We never went to sleep. We just passed out.
It's like the closest four guys ever get to each other without actually having sex with each other.
But if the band provoked hysteria in the heavy metal underground, they provoked horror in the world above.
We'd pull into truck stops and Gar would go in and buy like pickled pig's feet and a couple of beers.
We would go into some of these little podunk redneck truck stops and they kind of look at you like you're the devil incarnate and then they ask you who you are. Chris gets funny with them and he goes, oh, we're a gospel act.
I go, Megadeth. And they'd be, Megadeth, huh.
And you just go, oh my God, they're going to be waiting for us outside with pitchforks right now.
Parents criticized Megadeth for their hellacious looks and violent lyrics. But the music hit a nerve with America's disenfranchised youth.
I was a 13-year-old kid. It's everything you're looking for because you're so pissed off at the world. You know what I mean? It just empowers you. I mean, it's just powerful music.
They were truly angry. Truly angry young men.
By the spring of 86, Megadeth was developing a national reputation. Still, it paled next to that of Metallica.
They were leaving us behind. They were taking off. They were doing really good. And it was burning me up, you know?
He hated everything. He hated himself. He hated me. He hated the company. He felt that he could not break through unless he was on a major label.
The band's debut album had sold 100,000 copies, a decent tally for an independent label release, but not good enough for Dave Mustaine.
He was just like a rabid dog, man. He would just be like, arr, arr.
We said, hey, it's a process. We're growing up together. But he felt that we couldn't get him to the next level, so there was a tremendous anxiety between label and band and Dave. The last thing we wanted to do was sell Megadeth, but he was in a mode of denial that was kind of scary.
In the summer of 86, Cobrin sold Megadeth's contract to Capitol Records.
We recently made a pretty large step in life. We're now at a label called Capitol. Thanks to everybody out here that's been supporting us.
That November, the new label released Megadeth's follow-up album. Peace Sells, But Who's Buying was a quantum leap, both in terms of its quality and its complexity.
I think the thing that separated Megadeth from a lot of the other heavy metal bands was that it wasn't just, let's see how fast we can play and let's see how many demons and devils we can sing about. Dave Mustaine liked to really write about lyrics that meant something.
I was like a really big fan of Peace Sells. The second record I thought was an awesome heavy metal record at that time. And I listened to it a lot. And even though I certainly didn't tell anybody at the time, I was, I guess, secretly kind of proud of the work that he'd done because he had stepped up to the plate.
Peace Sells did sell. Audiences ate up the record critics call classic thrash metal, and it quickly moved 500,000 copies. But that didn't make Dave or the band any happier.
We were starting to become more reclusive, and in fact, there was a lot of infighting starting to happen in the band.
The song would end, and then, you know, Gar would throw a drumstick at Dave and hit him in the back of the head.
I swear to God, it was like Fight Club.
I don't know if this happens in other rock bands, but they were just literally like trying to kill each other, you know?
Me and Dave got in the biggest fight ever. Broke the toilet off the floor in the bathroom and then went out into the other room and smashed the headboard through the wall.
The room would be destroyed, you know? And it was like, you'd come in and you'd go, well, how did the bed break in half? You know, the bed just doesn't break in half, you know? And they're like, I don't know, you know, fuck it, you know, just get another bed in here, you know?
I used to love when the managers would just walk. The road managers would walk. Scott would never walk. You know what? Now to think about it, if anybody suffered, he did. Because he had to, like, you know, every little thing, every room destroyed. God, he had to take care of all of that.
In the winter of 86, Megadeth was hired to open for Alice Cooper on a lengthy concert tour. Even Rock's resident bad boy was stunned by Megadeth's partying habits, so much so that he summoned them to his bus one night.
So we kind of like, you know, kind of sober up a little bit. And no, we're going to Alice's bus, man. We got to like keep it down.
Basically, on a level of just telling him, look, I've done it all. I've seen it all. It doesn't work. You cannot, especially a show with your intensity. You're going to burn right out.
The last thing he said was, you guys be careful out here. And we were just like, what's he talking about? You know?
Cooper's words fell on deaf ears, and Megadeth's hardcore habits began to affect their performance on stage, especially when it was difficult to get heroin and they were in need of a fix.
Sometimes it showed up, and when it did, the shows were good, and when it didn't, the shows really sucked.
But as far as like us being too high or too drunk to play, it happened. It was hard to go up on stage if you were sick and have to drink it away. And then you had to find that point where you wouldn't be too drunk to play, you know, so it was kind of like, almost like a science, I guess, I don't know. But when we were on, no one could touch us at what we did.
The band ignored repeated pleas from friends to slow down. But after years of hardcore drug abuse, Dave Mustaine was beginning to crack up.
You know, he literally lost his mind, where he was saying to me, Scott, you have to, you know, you gotta check out my arm right here. There's something moving underneath there. And he's like, they're all over me, you know, their bugs are all over me, they're crawling all over me, you know, and I had never experienced anything like that, seen anybody in such bad shape.
He would go into these, like, total personality changes and either go really violent or, you know, be super nice, you know, so it was always kind of like, which Dave are we going to get tonight?
Chris and Gar weren't doing much better. Looking to increase their already prodigious drug intake, they asked Dave, the group's sole songwriter, for an increased share of Megadeth's profits. When Dave refused, Chris started pawning the band's gear to feed his growing habit.
Almost every week I would go to rehearsal and some of Gar's cymbals were gone because he'd hawk it for dope, or some of my guitars were gone because Chris Poland would hawk my guitars for dope.
Sometimes when you're short of cash, like my whole back line was gone one year. You know, I mean, I was crazy. I remember our manager, he goes, your stuff's where? I pawned it all, man. And they'd go, all right. And they had to go down and it'd be like, and they'd go to this pawn shop and it'd be like two whole stacks, four heads. The guy at the pawn shop would be like, damn it.
I, you know, I was a drug addict, man. It's not something I'm proud of. And I can look back and laugh now, and I'm lucky I can, you know?
We just realized it was done. It wasn't gonna work with those two in the band anymore.
To tell you the truth, I was like, whew, you know?
Chris and Gar were fired, and soon longtime road manager Scott Menzies walked away on his own, unwilling to witness Dave's demise.
I figured Dave would just die. That would be it, you know, and I didn't want to be there to see that.
Next, Mustaine and Ellefson bottom out.
We're four albums into Megadeth's career and didn't have a dime to my name.
And later, Megadeth loses a member of the family.
I pretty much came to the conclusion that the music world had lost a true giant.
By the summer of 87, just 4 years after the band was born, Megadeth seemed on the verge of a meltdown. Gar Samuelson and Chris Poland had been fired, and David Ellefson and Dave Mustaine were strung out on crack cocaine.
I would do that first hit of crack, and I would be gone for 3 days, 5 days sometimes. Once I put something into my body, I can't stop.
I mean, I was definitely his partner in crime and slime all the way down.
Amazingly, the drug abuse didn't derail Megadeth. In January 88, with Jeff Young on guitar and Chuck Baylor on drums, the band released So Far, So Good, So What, which became their biggest seller to date. The album also revealed a different side of Dave Mustaine. His song, In My Darkest Hour, was a metal elegy to Metallica bassist Cliff Burton, who died in a bus accident in September of 86.
As soon as I heard, I just picked up my guitar and I started crying, and I just wrote the song, the music, in one fell swoop from beginning to end.
It's a very, very heavy song and a really kind of classic piece of Megadeth that really displays their philosophy in a beautiful way.
Filmmaker Penelope Spheeris used the song to anchor her documentary, The Decline of Western Civilization, Part 2. The film celebrated the new heights being enjoyed by hardcore heavy metal. Ironically, within weeks of the movie's release in the summer of 88, David Ellefson hit rock bottom.
I remember we had just played really a monumental show for us, which was Monsters of Rock show in London.
When you drive up in the tour bus and see like an ocean of people as far as your eye can see, it's pretty amazing.
And I remember I was so dope sick and felt so horrible. We had two more shows we were supposed to do in Germany, and I had to cancel them. I had to announce to the world that, hey, guess what? I'm a heroin addict.
David immediately flew to Los Angeles and entered a detox center.
I'm probably the worst kind of drug addict there is, because I'm the guy who can look you in your face and lie to you, and this, or you ask me how it's going, I'm like, it's fine.
He hid it for a long time, and one visit back home, I know to us why, he told us he had the flu. Really, looking back, you know, we should have seen right then what was happening, but we didn't see him all that much either, so that made a lot of difference.
With his partner in crime surrendering his sins, Dave Mustaine went too, the first of 15 trips to rehab.
I remember going in there, and I said, you know what, I got a problem and I need help, and just started crying.
The worst part about going to rehab is it just ruins getting high. You just can't go get high after that. It just, because it's like being cursed with your conscience. You know.
We thought too, well, that could be the end of the band, because it was taking quite a toll on everybody.
David Ellefson was determined to stay clean, but within weeks, Dave Mustaine resumed his dance with the devil.
He went out and relapsed and got high. And my first thought was, man, that's my buddy. I'm out of here. This is my excuse. I can go now.
I wanted to spike his drink, and I wanted to sprinkle heroin on his food and just do anything I could to get my running partner back.
And I stopped, and I just like, wait a minute. It's like, I can't do this for him. I got to do it for me, otherwise I'm going to die. And that was the beginning of me staying cleaned up from that point on.
10 months and 12 days. Without any alcohol, marijuana, pot, cocaine, or heroin, thank you very much.
David Ellefson would stay clean, a feat that left Mustaine feeling alienated within his own band. In March of 89, Mustaine was arrested for erratic driving near his home in L.A. That he could drive at all was a near miracle.
I had 7 different things on me and about 9 different chemicals in me. I had no more intention of stopping there than I had to pull my own eyelids off.
I remember telling him, Dave, just pick one. Heroin, freebasing, pot, drinking, whatever it's going to be, but mixing all the stuff. I remember I was having nightmares about him in a casket.
No more Mr. Nice Guy.
That fall, Dave was asked to cover an Alice Cooper song for the Wes Craven film Shocker. By then, Dave could barely function.
They called me to do the video for "They Were Mr. Nice Guy." And Dave was so screwed up, he couldn't do the guitar playing and the lyrics at the same time. I mean, I was freaking out, going, I gotta get this video done, and this guy, you know, can't walk and chew gum here.
In a move that seemed out of character for the metal maniac, Dave reached out for help.
I called Alice, and he actually made a gesture to help me.
I mean, I'm not Dr. Cooper, but I definitely was the poster boy for abuse. I basically became his mentor when it came to that stuff. I told him, I said, if you get a problem, call me.
I can't remember if he offered or I asked him to be my godfather, but it came out so that he's my godfather now.
With Alice Cooper's help, Dave made another attempt to go straight, one that would last for over a year. In the winter of 89, Megadeth underwent yet another change in its lineup.
When Dave and I first met, the idea wasn't, well, it's you and me, and we're going to have this revolving door of a drummer and guitar player. That was never the case.
Drummer Chuck Baylor was fired soon after Mustaine dismissed Jeff Young. Dave suspected the guitarist of having an affair with his girlfriend at the time, Diana.
Dave called me up and said, you're trying to make something happen with Diana and I'm going to fire you from this band.
And I said, that's it. I said, Jeff, you're out.
I think it was the paranoia that was caused by the freebasing that he was doing where he accused me of trying to have an affair with Diana, which was untrue.
And I say, you're still fired. And that was the Jeff Young saga.
In the spring of 90, Megadeth entered the studio with two new members, guitarist Marty Friedman and drummer Nick Menza.
When I got into the band, I heard all these wild stories about drugs and addiction this and just insanity that. They were way cookies and milk compared to any image that people were telling me about.
When the band emerged in October 90, they'd molded a heavy metal masterwork. Lauded for complicated compositions like Hangar 18, Rust in Peace hit number 23 on the charts and quickly went platinum.
That album was really a landmark record for Megadeth. It established them not just as a heavy metal force, but as just the musical masterminds, really, that they get a lot of credit for being at this point.
We were rebuilding the beast. Megadeth's time had come. And that was really the time for us to go out and conquer and claim what we've been wanting to get for a long time.
The challenge was a difficult one. Mustaine and Ellefson were physically ravaged and flat broke.
And we're four albums into Megadeth's career and didn't have a dime to my name.
You're spending $300 to $500 a day, every day, snorting cocaine and heroin, you're gonna have money problems.
All these metal kids are looking up to us like we're, you know, big metal superstars. And little did they know, I had probably upwards of a couple hundred thousand dollars of tax debt and credit card debt just because I'd been strung out on dope.
To further the ironies, Dave Mustaine became the poster boy for MTV's Rock the Vote.
This convention will be taking place until Thursday. And God willing, we'll get some solutions by then. This is Dave Mustaine for MTV News, reminding you, register to vote.
Despite the chaos, the band went to work on their fifth album. Inspiration struck in a sunbaked warehouse in California's San Fernando Valley.
Wow, I can't even believe I found this place. This is an old rehearsal studio called the Power Plant. We used to come up here and rehearse. Man, we wrote a lot of stuff in here. Wow, a lot of history in here. Check this out. So this is it right here, room number three. This is where we wrote Rust in Peace in here. We auditioned Marty Friedman in there. We wrote and rehearsed most of Countdown to Extinction in there. In fact, you know what we'd do is we'd go in and we'd rehearse. And whenever we got stuck and couldn't come up with anything new, we'd come out here to the basketball court. We'd shoot some hoops for a while. And we'd go back in and Dave would write, gana, and all of a sudden we'd have sweating bullets. And then we'd like come out and shoot some more hoops again. And then we'd go back in, he'd pick his guitar up and he'd go, and then we had Symphony of Destruction. It was beautiful. It's like we were just banging out tunes left and right, thanks to that basketball hoop right there.
Megadeth turned their hook shots into a slam dunk. In the recording studio, they created a masterwork of metal. 1992's Countdown to Extinction debuted at number 2 on the pop charts and made them metal megastars.
Countdown to Extinction was the first record that had Megadeth songs played on the radio and had Megadeth songs played on MTV. They went from playing, you know, with 3,000 seaters and selling 600,000 or 700,000 copies of a record to selling over 2 million copies of that record in the United States alone and playing arenas.
When Countdown to Extinction debuted at number 2, we were sitting in the limo just getting the report, and I'm like, here I am, rocking around the world and hearing my record is like on top of the charts. It was like, could have just shot me right then, I would have been happy.
But in a cruel twist of fate, Metallica soon released their 5th album, and it debuted at number 1. Dave was devastated.
The success didn't matter. Countdown to Extinction was double platinum. That didn't matter. I had the house, I had the wife, I had the kid, I had everything. But I had nothing because I was still comparing myself to my previous band.
Hello, me. Meet the real me and my misfits way of life.
It's like you pull up to a stoplight, you know, and you have your own car, and so do they. They're both Mercedes, but yours says smaller number. I mean, it's like, you know, there's still that penis envy.
I witnessed that anger, you know, at the point where Dave had sold millions of records and had millions of adoring fans. He was still angry. He still was motivated by revenge.
You could see the decline of Dave slipping back into the old stuff again and getting high. And it was weird because, I mean, we were at the pinnacle of our career at that point. We were playing arenas and it was big.
Megadeth was, in fact, at the height of their popularity. And in February 93, they were booked to play the world-renowned Budokan Arena in Tokyo, Japan.
I was like, yeah, Budokan's ready for you. And I was like, this is great. This is better than being on the top of the charts. You know, Cheap Trick at Budokan, Megadeth at Budokan. We're here.
We were all kind of fragmenting a little bit because success was coming our way and we're all starting to make a little bit of money. Just everything that would pull us apart.
On February 17th, just days before they were to leave for Tokyo, Megadeth played a show in Eugene, Oregon. Dave was a disaster.
Dave was intoxicated. I was like, oh man, this is horrible. This sucks. And finally, it was almost like an act of God. The barricade down in front of the stage broke. And it was just like a big pop.
Last thing I remember, I incited a riot. Somehow, the barricade broke. Everybody rushed the stage.
We were like, we're out of here. That's it. Let's go.
But as soon as Dave left the venue, he swallowed a handful of Valium pills. And by the time he was hustled to an emergency room, he was rambling incoherently.
I was covered in sweat and piss and everything. They got me into pajamas, and then I died. They took me to an emergency room, and I was dead.
Dave was resuscitated at the hospital. When he regained consciousness, he was moved to the Meadows, a rehab center in Phoenix, Arizona.
Dave called us all and wanted us all to come out for a family week there. Here comes Megadeth marching in, you know. The counselors and people that Dave were working with said, look, you can't go on the road. If you go on the road too soon, it's going to be all over. We had to really just stop and just go, wow. I mean, Dave was almost a goner. If we would have continued on the road, it probably would have been one of those stories where rock star found dead in a hotel room.
My prayers are never answered.
The dream of playing Budokan was over. The trip was canceled.
It wasn't like, dude, I want to take this away from you guys. I want to deprive you of this cool chance. It happened, and I just felt bad to see him go through it. God, you know, it was that, for me, is probably, in the whole time of Megadeth, the most disappointing moment.
I never wanted to shake him. I wanted to hold him. The thing about metal, the image of metal was, you know, a bunch of tough guys playing this really heavy music. So I didn't need to shake him and ask why. I understood why. I understood Dave.
After rehab, Dave tried to live his life by new rules, including group therapy sessions scheduled around rehearsals.
Now we're like, oh, and after rehearsal, we're going to have to go over to a group therapy meeting. And huh? That's so un-rock and roll. What is this all about?
It was the most excruciating thing. You know, I'm sitting here and I'm listening to people that I'm basically paying their mortgage. I'm feeding them and their families tell me that I'm a bad guy. It was like having your butt hairs pulled out very slowly.
Attempting to stay clean, Dave no longer tolerated any drug use by his bandmates. So when he suspected Nick Menza was intoxicated, Dave snapped.
We had talked to our tour manager and he said, Nick, I want you to give me a urine test. And he said no, and I quit. And this is right before the concert. I had a hold of Nick's throat. We were in the lobby of a hotel in London and I was ready to kill him. I figured if I couldn't punch him in the face, I'd rip his throat out. You know what? He's messing with my bread and butter. I mean, he's affecting my income, which is messing around with my family. And, you know, I had had it.
Although intolerant of drug use within his own band, it wasn't long before Dave was back to battling his old demons. But in the summer of 93, he sobered up long enough to take part in a classic concert bill. In a series of European shows, Megadeth opened for Metallica, a once-in-a-lifetime battle of the bands.
We had pretty much avoided it just because of the competition. And at that point, we finally welcomed it. You know, said, let's see who's got the cojones now and who's going to rule the stage.
Of course, it was something that had been talked about for years. You know, would Metallica and Megadeth ever share a stage together?
Well, to get a chance to play with them again some way down the line in some way would be awesome.
It was the first time that Metallica had acknowledged that Megadeth were, you know, worthy enough.
It could have been a real big nightmare, but it turned out to be so cool.
It was awesome that it happened, and in some way, I think it kind of broke the ice.
Unaware of Mustaine's recent drug overdose, his former bandmates greeted him with a grim, practical joke.
We were sitting in the dressing room, and we came in really meekly to sort of say hello, and you were like over in the corner, like like laying out lines made of like, you know, sugar or something.
Yeah, we wound him up pretty good.
Right,
and
so
you know,
nasty.
It was pretty, could have been pretty evil. You know, we had no idea where his personality was at that point, but it was evil. You know, hopefully, you know, he took that as a funny thing.
The concerts were both cathartic and cruel for Dave, who kept a critical eye on Kirk Hammett, the guitarist who had taken his place in Metallica.
The first time that I heard how long that they allowed Kirk to do his solo, I thought, God, he's horrible.
I remember him just sitting backstage, just kind of watching the whole thing, and you know, I was feeling for him.
I thought, this is supposed to be me.
You know, I'm over it now, and I can see how hard he tries to do what he does. I mean, I think he makes really good use of what talent he has.
Despite his envy, overall, the tour was a high point for Mustaine.
Metallica really showed Dave and the group a real respect. For all the time Dave spent seeking revenge, and all the time Dave spent tortured because the band he got thrown out of became the biggest band in the world, I think this felt really good to Dave. And I think it felt really good to the guys in Metallica.
But in the months that followed, Dave resumed his march toward death's door.
Part of me wanted to go help him, but you can't help somebody who doesn't want to be helped. And, you know, Dave obviously probably didn't, he probably looked at me like I was some kind of a fink or a narc or something. He didn't want to be around me, you know.
It was hard. It was hard to see somebody you love hurt that bad. It was hard to see somebody you love lose control like that.
Not long after Megadeth released the album Euthanasia, Dave began shooting heroin for the first time.
As soon as I started using the needle, you know, I finally realized that, you know, the jig's up. I've lost this battle. I'll never win.
In November 95, friends finally accosted him outside a studio in Hollywood, just blocks from where Megadeth had been born a dozen years before.
I said, don't touch me. I don't want you to touch me. I didn't want anybody to touch me. I said, I'm going to go back in and shoot up one more time, and then I'll go to treatment. And they didn't let me, thank God, because I probably would have died.
Dave Mustaine immediately entered a California rehab clinic. It was his 15th attempt at getting sober.
It's been over 5 years. Man, I'm not a bad dude. I'm a sick dude. You know, it's like a disease is a disease, and people don't recognize alcoholism and drug addiction as a disease. They think it's a weakness.
Dave feels he's conquered his demons now. But it was a lesson that took 20 years of drug abuse, over a dozen trips to rehab, and one journey beyond the grave to learn.
We lost business opportunities for Megadeth because business opportunities were secondary to life opportunities. There would be no business opportunities if Dave is dead.
Be like, man, not only did you get a second chance at a second career, but you've had like 9 lives within this one.
I know now without a doubt that I have a disease, and it's not that I'm a weak person, it's just I got a sickness.
Dave Mustaine has been clean ever since, leaving him free to rekindle his relationship with his running partner, David Ellefson.
It's like you've gone to hell and come back.
Dave's the only one that's been able to really put his finger on what makes me tick and be able to, you know, stick with this thing.
A lot of what the last umpteen years was about for Dave and I was about getting back on the same page again, and it was cool. It was almost like two guys getting to know each other all over again.
With a bond of brotherhood stronger than ever, Megadeth returned to the studio. To pump up their next release, they hired manager Bud Prager, the man who helped fashion Foreigner into a pop sensation.
Bud comes in and he starts working with me, and we looked at the lyrics and made all the lyrics work and made all the melodies and everything work. He'd sold over 80 million records in America alone. And I thought, okay, my 20 million records around the world, your 80 million records in America, he's got me. So I wanted to listen.
Released in June of 97, Cryptic Writings was a huge hit. The single, Trust, shot to number one, the first of three to blaze into the top 20.
It was still real hard, real heavy, real rock, good amount of metal, good amount of heavy, just kind of mainstream rock, and then some other things that we had tried, and it worked.
Dave always seemed to have this little battle going on inside him. Do I want to write pop songs, or do I want to write metal songs? And I think Cryptic Writings was the record where he successfully took all of that and merged it into just a brilliant album.
Although Cryptic Writings was both a critical and commercial smash, success would not bring complete harmony to the band.
I'd already talked to Marty Friedman during Cryptic Writings tour about getting rid of Nick at the end of the tour because we just were not getting along anymore.
In the summer of 98, Dave fired Nick Menza, his drummer of nearly a decade. Former Suicidal Tendencies drummer Jimmy DeGrasso immediately joined the band mid-tour.
I told Jimmy DeGrasso to come on. He came out 5 days notice.
They were in the middle of a tour. I had like 3 days to learn all the songs. So I was just like staying up all night, you know, pacing around the hotel with a Walkman on and like a pot of coffee.
No sound check. We did a line check in Fresno, outdoor gig. So everyone heard everything we did, and intro tape rolls. Jimmy hits 1, 2, 3, 4, boom. The whole concert, not a hitch. Seven Dust and Monster Magnet are on the side of the stage with their arms like this watching us, waiting for a train wreck that never happened, and I knew I'd made the right decision.
In the summer of 99, Mustaine and Ellefson got a grim reminder of the perils of Megadeth's early drug abuse. The band's original drummer, Gar Samuelson, was gravely ill with liver disease.
When Gar started to get sick, I went down to visit him, and like a week later, he had passed away, and passed away on Bastille Day.
Gar Samuelson died on July 22, 1999. He was just 41 years old.
Dave called me up and told me, he said, Gar's dead. And for a minute, I was just I got goosebumps. I got goosebumps just now even talking about it, just remembering it.
I pretty much came to the conclusion that the music world had lost a true giant.
Megadeth soldiered on, returning to the studio to record their eighth album, Risk. Hoping to repeat their success of Cryptic Writings, Risk was an even more melodic departure from their trademark heavy sound.
Cryptic Writings did really well, and I thought, this works, more of this will work even better. So we went in that same direction on Risk.
Released in August of 99, Risk went gold, but the album suffered a harsh backlash from hardcore fans and critics alike.
Risk was a risk, and I don't think it went over as well as people had hoped it would. It was a lot more pop than it was metal. I think he was hoping to have more success at radio with the record, and it didn't come.
We knew it was going to be one of those records that is going to be hit or miss in a very big way. It's either going to be enormous or it's going to be a terrible failure. That's why we called it Risk.
The criticism caused longtime guitarist Marty Friedman to question his future with the band.
And I just happen to be a pop guy. I love pop music. I love rock music. I'm not the greatest fan of heavy metal, thrash metal.
After a decade of assaulting audiences with ear-splitting metal riffs, Marty Friedman had had enough.
I was no longer interested in the music and what was best for the band. You play long enough in a band and you start to do it on autopilot.
I'd be like, come on, man. What's really going on here? Why would you quit right now? You know, I mean, you're in this far. Why would you quit? And he's like, I just don't want to do this anymore. I just don't want to play this kind of music, and I'm into doing some other things.
I had to leave. It was strictly musical, and it had nothing to do with anything personal. And it came to the point where, you know what, I felt like my ability wasn't being used at all in the band. You know, I was giving everything I could, but like maybe, you know, 2% of what I'm capable of doing was making it to any records. You know, if your name is Megadeth, you can't have a very colorful palette, you know what I mean? Your music is gunmetal gray, you know what I mean? I like to, you know, paint with purple and yellow and green and orange and red and black and white.
Marty Friedman left Megadeth in January of 2000. He was replaced by Al Petrelli, a seasoned studio musician whose talents were tested by Mustaine's musical boot camp.
Dave said, it's 15 minutes to the show, why don't you get dressed, you're playing tonight. And instantly had an anxiety attack. I'm playing somebody else's guitar in somebody else's band and really never did the formal rehearsing.
With the new additions of Jimmy and Al, Dave saw to it that his band was tighter than ever.
Being a session guitar player in New York, you walk in, they put a chart in front of you, you read it, you play it, you're done. You know, and I'd be home in time for The Simpsons. This isn't how this was working, and Dave would test me every day.
We get in the studio, he's like, well, I'll do this, and I can do that and match him. Or I'll play something on my bass drums and he can match it on guitar, and it's kind of cool.
Sit down, me and him together, and he'd go over every nuance of every note and every song in the set. And this went on for the better part of a year. So I'm like, this guy's relentless. But that's why he is who he is, and the band is as successful as they are.
Whether taskmaster or teacher, Mustaine has always been a man of commitment.
He's got an honor code about him that's pretty intense. If he says he's going to do something, he'll do it.
While in rehab, Dave Mustaine would get on the phone and do his interviews. He would get on stage, you know, while throwing up from having too many drugs or not enough drugs in him.
I've never walked off stage. I've always shown up, no matter how dope sick I was.
Dave is not a man of half measures. He's a man who commits completely to everything he chooses to do. Dave understood that drugs were gonna destroy him, his life, and his career, but he made that choice.
He went from being a skinny, little, obnoxious punk to being a really centered, intelligent person. The guy's been reborn.
Dave's commitment extends to every aspect of his life these days. Married in 91, Dave and his wife Pamela have two children, Justice and Electra.
To be a member of a big giant rock band comes with tremendous responsibility. You pay a dear price. You pay the price of privacy, you pay the price of spending any significant time with your family, and Dave paid that price. And although he didn't verbalize it to me. His actions kind of dictated that in this new commitment to recovery, he was committed to spending time with his wife and his kids.
Dave Mustaine has seen a life full of challenges. But his life has become influential beyond powerful riffs and political statements.
At the time I met Dave, I was just, my life was a wreck. He offered to help me if I was willing. I thought about it for a couple of days, and I knew that it was going to be serious because I knew I couldn't bullshit Dave Mustaine.
Mega fan and friend Eric Cogdell approached Dave Mustaine for an autograph while battling his own addictions.
We spoke every day since, or I've at least, you know, checked in with him every day since for the past, you know, 3.5 years. I feel like I owe my life to him, you know. I feel that God put Dave Mustaine in my life, you know, in order to save me.
For those who are part of Megadeth today, the focus is exclusively on the music.
Once we got our act cleaned up, then we became the streamlined operation. You know, wherever Megadeth went, man, it was like a military operation. It's like we just came in and destroyed and left.
I know what I'm doing, and I'm doing what I know.
One of the first things Dave said to me is like, when you walk off of this bus or walk out of your hotel room, you will be dressed properly, okay, and for God's sakes, get rid of those circles under your eyes.
Megadeth released their 9th album in May 2001. The World Needs a Hero is an uncompromising return to the band's hard-rocking roots.
We just went in there and said, what do you feel like playing? And we just took it from there, and ideas just kept rolling and rolling and rolling, and we just kept, you know, writing songs.
We really wanted to just make a full-on slamming metal album, which is what we've made. The cool thing in our case is that it's been a slow 18-year uphill journey. And because of that, we're still here to talk about it. Fortunately, we live to talk about it. We've had more second chances at this thing than anybody I possibly know.
He's got a horseshoe up his ass for sure. Yeah, he's escaped some hairy stuff for sure. And I mean, we're glad that he's still alive on the planet doing what he wants to do.
Wherever Megadeth goes in the future, its place in heavy metal history is already secure, thanks largely to a guitar genius named Dave Mustaine.
He's one of the major influences as far as guitar playing. He was certainly one of the founders of that seriously crunch, mid-range, just balls out rhythm tone.
Megadeth has been one of the world's biggest heavy metal bands for 16 years now. He's been doing something right.
If you have the privilege of penetrating the real Dave Mustaine, you know what a great guy he is.
People want stuff that's gonna, you know, make you wanna fuck or fight. And, you know, I know you're gonna beep that, but that's what they want from us. They want heavy music that's gonna get you stirred up and think.
He's deep and he's wicked and he's uncompromising, you know, so I think for all that, he'll go down in history as a pretty cool dude.
I wanted to be important and I wanted to fit in. And I found the place where I fit in, you know, and if it all ended.